Please be seated. You know, if it wasn't for the Spirit of God, this would really be either extraordinarily silly or presumptuous at best. I mean, lofty words, are they not? In the song that we sing, facing a task unfinished, we bear the torch that flaming fell from the hands of those who gave their lives proclaiming that Jesus died and rose. Ours is the same commission, the same glad message, ours fired by the same ambition. To thee we yield our powers. The image, of course, is a relay race. And just as one is coming toward the finish line, passing the torch, coming to the finish line for them meant martyrdom. And as they drop their hand, there is one to say, I'm here, let's go. And that one runs the next piece of the race, knowing that at the end, they too, either by martyrdom or natural causes, will lay down the torch for another to pick up, not for it to go dead. That's what I meant when we're being invited into a stream of something that God has been doing ever since the heralding of his Son, raising up men and women who understand that by his sovereign choice, they are not formed for normal life as this world knows it. They don't quite fit in. They don't have quite the same passion for the same things that some of their peers might have. They find themselves stealing away to be alone with God at sometimes the oddest of times. And they have the experience, not just once, but again and again until they get the idea that they're actually in training, though they may not have known it. To find themselves in a situation where God is asking them to say something or to do something that requires a level of courage, a level of fortitude, a willingness to step out a little bit that they weren't used to, and yet here it is, and God, I want to be faithful to you, so here we go. And like working a muscle in a workout session, what begins to happen is that the courage comes more easily, the step into the breach becomes more deliberate, and even though there is always a certain level of, oh no, what if this doesn't work out? That never goes away, by the way. Right? Right. You're still willing to say, by the mercy of God, I'm going. Let's go. Let's see what happens. You see, that's really the message of the psalm that we read tonight. May God be merciful to us and bless us. Show the light of his countenance and come to us. And then the next line is, why are we asking God to do that? May your way be known upon earth, your saving help among all nations. In other words, there is nothing in the scripture, nothing, that understands that the very nature of why God has given us a certain level of well-being, of peace, in the grace of the gospel, the assurance of forgiveness of sins, the promise of eternity, is just so that we can somehow feel better about ourselves. It's just not there. Instead, all of those things that God gives us, that are in fact part and parcel of what it means to be a believer in Jesus, is that so when the opportunity comes for us to step out of what normal life might feel like, we're actually willing. Because it is not about, in the end, my well-being at all. Instead, it is about yours and my availability for service. And the peace and the forgiveness and the assurance, the healing that God does in our life changes, that he works in the deepest parts of who we are, that really causes us to see the world from a very different vantage point. Even perhaps from the vantage point that we were taught as children. Perhaps even in Sunday school, We begin to see things differently in a way that more accurately reflects the vision of Jesus. And he begins to open up the doors and in essence say, okay, now it's your turn. Equipped to give. Equipped to serve. It really is a profound heresy in the life of the church that really understands the gifts of God as the things that God chooses to give me so that I can have a happy, normal life. I dare anyone to prove that in the scripture today. It's just quite the opposite. That how the Bible defines happy, fortunate to be envied, are peacemakers, those who mourn. In other words, people who are willing to step into the lives of other people around them in a way that invites them, in fact, even though they are not always conscious of it, to make an eternal difference in their lives. They are commissioned people. Even in our services, will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself? If somehow that gets dumbed down merely to just say, my job is to be courteous, or nice, or not at least overtly hateful, we miss the point entirely. No, again, it's a call to mission. It's a call to be available for God to use you. I mean, in a sense, Loren and Linda are not changing locations. They're changing venues. And that's all. That venue will ask of them things that are not being asked of them now. But that's only because a twofold plan is at work. One is that God is deeply committed to working in Loren and Linda, conforming them to the image of his Son. And God will use their time in Southeast Asia to more deeply work that change out in them. You're going to see Loren and Linda, if they come back or when they do, on some sort of furlough, and you'll go, you know, in some ways you're the same person, but in other ways, you're different. That's what Jesus does, you see. We are, in fact, constantly being changed, invited to say yes to the process of change. But again, it's not merely a kind of inward myopia. They're actually being sent because God loves those people just as much as he does anybody else. And they're supposed to hear the good news of the gospel. And that is a divine appointment that God has created. And he said, guess what, Linda and Loren, you get to be a part of it. But that is also true for us. Our neighbors, our friends, our enemies, our co-workers are people that God loves just as much as he loves us. And in the very same way that God is sending them, and in sending them, changing them, and in changing them, making them even more useful, for the sake of sharing that wonderful and great and glorious good news with people whom he has appointed for them to share it with, it's also true for us. That we are also under, you see, a mandate of divine appointment. You did not choose me. I chose you to go and bear fruit. Jesus said that. So that wherever we are, we're also invited to look at the people who are around us and say, who, Lord? Not if, when? How? Not whether or not. And doing what one can to prepare so that when the opportunity arises, out of friendships that are being built, to talk about what God is doing in your life, there are words that he gives you to do it. And you're willing to step out. Forming a heart of prayer and compassion so that when these people who are in your life become for you an intercessory burden, that as you pray for them, God changes you in a way that only deepens your love for them. And so that when you speak, it's not not out of this, doesn't look like reward, but out of a desire, a servant's heart desire, to share the most precious thing you know. To share the most precious thing you know. You were given a rope. Did you get a piece of rope? At the beginning of the service. So you got a rope and you got a rope. The rope is meant to indicate, the analogy actually is a rope's course, if you've ever been on a rope's course. There might be a person way up there trying to make his or her way across this tightrope. But the real story is that the only way that's actually going to happen, unless a person is extraordinarily acrobatic, is if all of these other people who are doing their part, holding their rope, so that balance happens way up in the sky somewhere, so that the person successfully gets across. In other words, even though the focus might be on the person on the tightrope, the fact of the matter is there is a team effort of many ropes, which in fact helps make that possible. And without those ropes, it could not happen. You got a rope. And it's a rope from Loren and Linda. It's not from the Cathedral. It's not even from me, it's from them. Because they've invited you to say, okay, I'll stand underneath that tightrope for Loren and Linda. I'll pull on the rope, and that pull might look like prayer, that pull might look like emails, that pull might look like financial contributions, that pull might look like paying attention to what's going on in that part of the world, politically, socioeconomically, and thinking immediately about what kind of impact that might have on Loren and Linda, and praying for them. That might be prayer and support and provision for their sons. It takes all of that, you see, for that to happen. The tendency for people who live in, who are Americans especially, when they find themselves living in another part of the planet, is to feel cut off, stranded as it were, in the land of the unfamiliar, having relied only upon not this grand, glorious network that all of us take for granted, but actually quite a small group of people. And so to take the rope says, it's not gonna happen. We're here, we're holding the rope. And it's not that somehow they need particularly American prayers. There'll be plenty of people in other parts of the world who are praying too, including people who will pray in intercession that this Romans 8 describes as even groanings too deep for words, that they don't even know who they're praying for, but God is appointing them to lay within them a call to pray in a way that actually makes a difference in Loren and Linda's life, even though they may not know it. That's a part of the alchemy of intercession. It's a part of something far bigger than anything we could ever ask or imagine. And I want you to know, sisters and brothers, that we get to get in on all of this. I mean, I cannot tell you the joy, the excitement, the sense that I have that we're a part of this stream, and I get to be invited in. And while I'm just the rope holder right now, I've got another venue that I'm called to actually serve in an active way. The rope is seriously important. And so I'm taking up the rope, and it's for their sake, because they need that network of support just like the rest of us do. And therefore, I get to be a part of that network. It's not a burden. It's really not. It's not even at its heart an obligation. It's actually an invitation to somehow, again, by God's mercy, get in on what it is that God wants to do. And in a very specific way, through Loren and Linda. And there are others. I need to read a couple of things to you. These are others who are not in this room, who are holding on to their piece of the rope. These are people who are genuine leaders in the missionary life of our church, who were very more than happy to say, I'm in. These are people who will be known to them, and maybe not to all of us. The first is Ken and Ted Wardenick, founder, first director of Anglican Frontier Missions. He writes, For over 20 years, Loren and Linda have had enough adversity, challenge, diverse situations, networking experiences, insights given to many and received from colleagues, life in difficult circumstances, pleasurable natural wisdom and revelations from God to make them outstanding servants where God has now called them. My wife Connie and I count Loren, Linda, and their boys as dear friends. We have had wonderful times together in many different places. I know that's true. I'm thankful for sending out this remarkable couple and being a part of it. God has prepared you well, Loren and Linda. From Stuart Wicker, President and Missions Director of the Society of Anglican Missions and Senders. 9 months ago, when I was a guest in the Diocese of Central Florida's annual convention, he came and was a part of our convention. He's a dear guy. Loren Fox and I renewed our lively discussion that we've enjoyed for many years about our mutually shared passion, to desire to engage Episcopal churches more deeply into our Lord Jesus Christ's call to make disciples of all nations. Knowing how Loren and Linda always walk their talk. Yeah, right? It was little surprise to hear of their own call to return to Asia to invest their lives in the people the church sends, to the pressing need to share the gospel with those yet reached, and faithfully to continue growing your hearts in Christ as their leaders. In God's timing, this very week I participated in a global missions consultation in Asia with 23 nations present. The future supervisor of Linda and Loren, whom I met at that conference though many years ago, was also there. It was great to see. As your commission and send-off for this couple today, please know that in Asia, Loren and Linda are very much anticipated and already highly esteemed in the Lord. And then lastly, from the Reverend Janet Eccles, she writes, John Stott said, we must be global Christians with a global vision because we serve a global God. Loren and Linda live that out. Why, even their marriage is cross-cultural, exclamation. From the time I first met them in seminary, when they were working in an inner city church, until now, they have persevered in this global vision with Anglican Frontier Missions in Singapore and building a multinational faith community in Florida as mobilizers for an unreached people group, and now their call back to Asia. All this is at great personal cost, financial, physical, and family. They have sacrificed much, and they will sacrifice more. But oh, what they have gained. To paraphrase Jim Elliot, Loren and Linda willingly give what they cannot keep to gain what they cannot lose. My hope and prayer is that everyone here today will join in their sacrifice, will become global Christians through joining Loren and Linda on mission, and a commitment to pray, to give, to go. That's it in a nutshell, isn't it? All of us are goers. The question is, where? All of us are prayers. The question is, for whom? All of us are givers. The question is only, how? And in the places where God's put us, as we continue to say yes, not to make me a better me, but to be available for God to use me, a shift happens inside, and all of a sudden, phrase, God so loved the world, becomes something that transforms your heart. So tonight, you who are here, including from as far away as Palme, Florida, as well as others who perhaps might wonder why your service has been hijacked because you're regulars at the cathedral and have no idea that this was going to happen, I invite you to join all of us together in praying for Loren and Linda and figuring out what this might mean for you. Let us pray. Lord, in the midst of the largeness in the midst of the small choices that are made every day to to live or not to live out this call. We pray that you would do your work in our hearts. Expand us, O Lord. Help us more and more to see this lonely, broken, and beautiful planet and all who are in it as you see them in your great love and compassion, which knows no bounds and that crosses every boundary, race, class, tribe, and geography, language, people, because it is your desire that all be held within your saving grace. And so, Lord, in the midst of such an extraordinary invitation, we do say to you, O God, please change our hearts and use us as you see fit. For it is in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord,